Over the years, I have covered a lot of different patents on this channel, but the one that I'm going to talk about today outscores all of them in one category. And that category is the extent to which a patent embodies the rampant superficiality present in today's society. An interesting category, isn't it? When I first heard about this patent just a few days ago, I honestly thought it was some sort of a joke, especially because it's coming from a serious, successful, large OEM like Yamaha. But it's not a joke. Yamaha did actually patent a fake engine. Somebody spent company resources to get it done. So now allow me to take you through it, to explain how it works. There is a technical aspect to it. And then after you have been fully informed, after I have filled your precious mental storage with this bizarre information, I would really, really like to hear your opinion about it, because I feel like I'm missing something here. So, the whole reason behind the patent, why it was done, is that apparently Yamaha believes that motorcycle buyers don't want electric motorcycles because they don't make the right sounds and they don't vibrate. Allow me to quote directly from the patent. Please don't pay attention to the style, the wording, how it's written, because it's been machine translated from Japanese. So just listen to the message, to the point it's trying to make. So, a driver of a straddle type vehicle is a motorcycle, using the reciprocating engine as a power source, feels a feeling of care by bodily sensing sound, vibration, or the like generated in response to an accelerator operation by the driver. Therefore, some straddle-type vehicle riders have a desire to drive a straddle-type vehicle that can experience sound and vibration specific to the reciprocating engine while suppressing emissions of carbon dioxide. Okay, and how does Yamaha plan to fulfill the wishes of future straddle-type vehicle drivers? With this. And this is a, I have to quote again, a vehicle-driving motor having an appearance similar to that of a conventional reciprocating engine, which is basically patent speak for fake engine. This fake engine is a permanent part of the motorcycle. It consists of an actual crankshaft, actual conrod, actual piston, cylinder, cylinder head, and valves. All of these are real moving parts, and to top it all off, the engine has some sort of variable valve lift mechanism. The engine does not burn any fuel or produce any power, but it does do the four strokes. However, they are not like the four strokes that we are used to. During the first stroke, the piston is going from bottom to top dead center and compressing the air. During the second stroke, the piston goes back down, the exhaust valve opens, and the compressed air is escaping through the exhaust valve. The engine produces quote-unquote exhaust sound during this stroke. On the third stroke, the piston goes up from bottom to top dead center, and on the fourth stroke, the piston is going back down. What's very important to note is this part right here, which shows us that the intake valve is very slightly open. And as you can see, it remains in this barely open position throughout the four strokes. A barely open valve, of course, means that some air is free to escape, so the engine isn't fully compressing it like a real engine, but it is still compressing it to some extent, to a significant extent, which is confirmed by the patent. This air compression is very important because it is the release, the sudden release of compressed air through the intake or the exhaust valve and the associated intake and exhaust resonator chambers. It is this that creates the engine-like noises. But as we know, compressing air takes up energy, which means that it's a loss. As we know, this engine doesn't burn any fuel, so how does it work? How does it run then? It is in fact driven by the electric motor of a battery electric motorcycle. So for this engine to produce engine-like sounds, it has to compress the air, and for it to produce engine-like vibrations, it must reciprocate its piston and rotate its crankshaft, and as we know, all of these are losses, which means that the engine is actually taking away some of the power from the electric motor. But don't worry, Yamaha has a solution. In fact, two solutions. The first one is an alternate operating mode, during which the intake valve is opened more during the first stroke, and the exhaust valve remains barely open throughout the other strokes, which allows more air to escape from the engine, reducing compression and reducing losses, but also reducing the amount of sound coming from the engine. The second solution is a clutch, which can completely decouple the fake engine from the electric motor, which eliminates all the sound and all the vibration, but also eliminates all the losses from the engine. Okay, so it's a fake engine, big deal. It's not like OEMs didn't do fake stuff before. Fake exhausts, fake air intakes.
A fake.
Fake calipers. Triumph did fake carburetors. The Hyundai Ioniq 5N, it has fake gear shifting. There's a bunch of fake stuff out there. Yes, but it's just cosmetic gimmicks or things that you can easily turn off if you don't like them. There's no performance penalty for any of this stuff that I just mentioned. Unlike for Yamaha's fake engine. Think about it. This is a non-removable permanent part of the motorcycle. This is, if it looks like a real engine, it's the same size as a real engine, which means that it takes up significant precious space on the bike, space that could otherwise be used for batteries or other components or storage or, I don't know, something useful. In order to produce engine-like sound, the engine must run at the same RPM as real engines. And to survive actual real RPM, 5, 6, 7, 8,000 RPM, the components, the fake rotating assembly, has to be sufficiently strong. And as such, it has to have a relatively significant weight, which means that this fake engine as a whole has significant weight. It adds weight to the motorcycle, which of course negatively impacts handling and performance. And while it's running, while it's doing the sounds and the vibrations, it is taking away energy from the motor and the batteries, which means that while it's running, it is reducing the performance and the range of the motorcycle. Everybody else decided to fake things with speakers, but not Yamaha. They decided to fake an engine with an actual engine. If you think about it, this is the most purest way of faking something, which I can't believe is a sentence I just said.
Well, you can make it roar with Mattel's terrific new Baroom hot rodder engine. Put it on a trike like this, or like this. You get your own special key. The remote control is up here where it belongs. Sounds like a real engine.
My personal subjective opinion is that this is very obviously unnecessary, wasteful, and stupid. And I'm saying this as somebody who really likes Yamaha. I owned and still own Yamaha products. I think they make great bikes. I think the T7 is still the best adventure bike money can buy. I rebuilt engines with Yamaha designed cylinder heads, and just overall, I really like engines. At the same time, I know that the combined intelligence and industry insight and other competences of the people working for Yamaha must be far greater than mine. But despite knowing this, I can't rationalize the existence of this patent. I know people like engines. I know that. And I know many think that they're the soul of the vehicle. I think that too sometimes. But this is not the way forward. Think about it. You're wasting precious resources to manufacture something that does nothing. You're wasting battery energy, performance, range to power something that does nothing. And I have so many more questions about it. Like, if it has a rotating assembly, then it must be lubricated. Do you have to change the oil? Imagine changing the oil. Imagine servicing something that does nothing. If it has a rotating assembly and a piston that has to seal a cylinder to some extent, then it also produces friction, and friction is heat. So does it need a cooling system of some kind? And if it breaks down, would you fix it? Would you pay actual money to fix something that does nothing? Also, I think that patent offices, they need some sort of common sense check or something. I don't know how this patent got granted. Where's the innovation? It's just a fake of something real. Does that mean that I can patent anything fake? Like, I'm going to patent a fake blender. It has the vibration and the noise of an actual blender, but it keeps your fruit 100% intact. Why? Why would you do that? I don't know. So your neighbors think that you're living a healthy lifestyle. I'm often accused of being anti-EV in my videos, which is not true. I'm not anti-EV. I'm anti-false advertising. I'm anti-hype. I'm anti-making bombastic promises and then delivering one third or one half of it. I test drove a Tesla Model 3. I hated the user interface.
Who designed this?
But I really genuinely enjoyed the driving experience. I think the car is very capable and in its own different way, it's fun to drive. I enjoyed driving it.
Hats off to the engineers, to the people who worked on the drivetrain, on how this thing performs, how it accelerates, how it merges, how it corners.
I also really like off-road riding. I like dirt bikes. I own a two-stroke. I love two-strokes. But also, I would really like a Stark Varg. And the only reason I'm not buying it is because I can't justify the cost for the range that I'm getting. Sometimes I'm pretty sure that the range would be perfectly fine for me on some days, but on other days I have more time, I want to ride more, I feel adventurous, I don't want to go home. That's it. Actually, no, it's not. I'm lying. There's one more reason I'm not buying the Stark Varg. It's not the main reason, but it's a reason. It's that the company behind it is called Stark Future. Why didn't they just call it Stark? Why did you have to add the future? This is the kind of thing that I don't like in the EV ecosystem. It used to be very present before, but it is still present. It is the I don't know what it is. It is just the hype, the big something. Like, what are you implying? That only your company is the future and nothing else is the future? It's like tech bro overcompensating is in the very name of your company. Instead of letting your product speak for itself, focus on that. It's an amazing product. I think that the Stark Varg is an amazing bike. And I don't think that a lack of an engine means a lack of personality. There's a lot of hate around this bike, which I think is hilarious. If you don't like it, don't buy it. The end. If you look at the videos of that bike when people are on the throttle, it makes some sort of whine. It makes some sort of its own distinct characteristic thing. It's the fastest accelerating dirt bike in the world, I think. It has a distinct, unique personality of its own. And it is different from what many people expect. But I don't think that the fact that it's different means that an entire fake personality should be forced onto that machine. If you don't like it, don't buy it. This is why I'm really perplexed because I think that what I'm saying right now is something extremely obvious. Getting something patented is not an insignificant amount of effort. You need to use the lawyers that are either already on your payroll or outsource something to get it done, to get it written. You have to pay fees. I have no idea. You have to draw up the text. You have to hire engineers to do the drawings, to explain it, there's effort in it. Companies don't go through effort and they don't spend money unless they think there's something in it. And so that's why I'm struggling to rationalize it. One possible approach towards rationalizing this patent is that maybe Yamaha knows something we don't. Maybe Yamaha, based on something, believes that battery technology will progress so much in the near future that it will be able to afford heavy, energy-sucking gimmicks like this entire fake engine. Maybe the battery power energy density is going to skyrocket. I don't think that's very likely, but It's one approach to rationalize it. Another one is that Yamaha believes maybe that resistance to electric bikes will be so high that some people will simply refuse to buy them if they don't look, sound, and shake the way they're expected. Maybe they had a focus group of the most hardcore petrolheads you can imagine. And then based on that, they decided to invest in a potentially lucrative deal that will give them a patent, which will make them the only ones capable of tapping into that specific market in that way. But even this doesn't make sense, because hardcore petrolheads, they pride themselves on their ability to tell engines by ear. They can hear something coming, it's a V-twin, Ducati. And then it stops, you know, at the traffic light, it idles, and then they go, dry clutch. Hardcore petrolheads, they really hate fake things. And you see, it's called a Ducati. It's not called Ducati Future, BMW Future, Suron Future. It's just Suron. So, I can't rationalize it. So, now I really want to hear your opinions. What do you think about this? Can you rationalize it? Would you ever consider buying something like this? Do you think Yamaha's onto something? Do you think I'm missing something? Is there a bigger picture I'm just not seeing? Whatever, just give me your thoughts, please. As always, thanks a lot for watching, and I'll be seeing you soon with more fun and useful stuff on the D4H channel. Just one more thing. You might be wondering if an engine that doesn't do combustion can actually produce a proper engine-like sound. And the answer is yes, it can. A while ago, I had the opportunity to visit a high-tech engine factory. And there, right before the end of the production line, before they start the engine for the first time, they do what's called a cold cranking. They hook up the engine to an electric motor, and then they spin it up to high RPM without starting the engine. This checks the oil pressure, the variable valve timing, a bunch of sensors, water pump rotation, timing belt stuff, you name it. It gives the technicians the opportunity to find potential issues in any of these systems and fix them before the engine is actually started for the first time. Now, the audio in my clip is pretty poor because there's a lot of background noise, but here's a different clip to give you an idea of what cold cranking sounds like.